Amity and Al, episode 144, part 2 of our ARISS contact, ARISS to the max. The kids, the teacher, and the ham. Okay, the contact is over. Life goes on. But I brought a few of the key participants back together to talk about how things got started. I talked to Betty Bigney. Betty is the STEM teacher, that's science, technology, engineering, and math, and this ARISS contact was her baby. And I'll talk to Frank, W4UOR. Frank is the president of the Onslow Amateur Radio Club. And when Betty went hunting for hams, Frank was the guy with the big red target on his back. But I'm going to start with a couple of kids, Aubrey and Joy, because after all, this whole thing is about them. What I want to find out from you guys is, first of all, what you did. What was this thing all about? I want from your perspective, what was this thing all about? Aubrey's pointing at Joey, saying, Joey, Joey, you tell her.
It was about...
And give me your outdoor voice, too. Talk.
Good. It was pretty amazing.
Well, that's how it felt, but what was it about? What did you do?
We talked to the astronauts on the space station.
Okay. Did you ever think you'd be able to do that?
No.
Ever in your life?
No.
Your long, long... How old are you?
11.
Aubrey, how old are you?
9.
All right. So in your long, long lives, never thought you'd be talking to an astronaut. How did this come about for you guys? What happened to get started?
Well, there was... Miss Bigney told, like, she made an announcement that she was going to have, Can I call it a contest?
Yeah,
a contest, I guess. But, so what you do is you write down your questions that you want to ask, and she'd select 20 questions from one person. Well, no, not 20 questions for one person, but a question to a person for only 20 people in the entire school.
Okay. So how many people did it start with? Everybody in the school? People in your class?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody in the school? Betty?
Everybody in the school. Over 900 students were asked to submit questions.
Okay. So there was a big potential audience. What did you submit?
I submitted... when you weren't working, do you have a favorite way to spend your free time?
Okay. And Aubrey, what did you submit?
How long does it take to become a fully trained astronaut?
Those are some pretty good questions. Did you expect that you'd get selected?
Not really.
What was your confidence level?
It was like halfway.
maybe not. Did you want to?
Mm-hmm.
Is it something you wanted to do? Aubrey, would you really want to?
I really, really wanted to do this.
I was
so excited that I submitted 12 questions.
Oh, cool. So the one that got selected was, what do you do?
How long does it take to become a fully trained astronaut?
Yeah. What kind of other questions did you submit?
A little hard to remember them because it was such a long time ago.
So did you lobby Miss Bigney to get selected? Did you hire a lawyer?
No.
Wouldn't have helped.
So you just handed in your question and then crossed your fingers.
No. Saying,
please, oh please, I want to do this.
I kept asking everyone, what day is it going to be? What day is it going to be? When is Miss Bigney going to announce it? I need to know.
Were you as excited as Aubrey was? Were you really want to do it?
I wasn't there the Monday that they were going to announce it, because I was in Pittsburgh. So I was driving back that Monday, and I was like, please, please, please.
You don't look old enough to drive.
I was riding the car.
What were you doing in Pittsburgh?
Just visiting people.
Okay. They hauled you out of school. Took you to Pittsburgh. Yeah, cool. So when this got started... had you guys, you guys are in Miss Bigney's class? Are you both in one of her classes? Okay. And she teaches what they call STEM. Do you know what STEM is?
I don't know what it stands for.
Yes, science, technology, engineering, and math. Now, you guys are both too young to have decided what you want to be when you grow up. But you're probably not too young to know the kinds of things you're interested in. Science, engineering, that kind of stuff interesting to you? Or was it just astronaut, astronaut, astronaut?
Engineering.
I think she seems sure of what it is she wants to do. How about you,
Civil engineering.
You have plotted your futures out. You know what you want to do when you grow up. You have some room to change your mind, but that sounds pretty cool. Why are you so interested in these things? Aubrey, what has you so positive you want to be in engineering?
Well, I heard lots of stories from Mrs. Bigney. I'm pretty sure that she said her son is an engineer, and I thought it sounded pretty interesting to me. So I'm like, I really wanted to do it.
What do you know about it?
This is
one of the tough questions I'll ask.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a few different kinds. You know, there's electrical, mechanical, computers.
Computers mostly.
Okay,
I'm really good at those.
Computers catch your attention. You must be a kid. Joey?
Civil engineering, because at AIG we're doing this thing. I don't talk good.
You're doing fine.
It's a project for AIG. Building bridges.
Mm-hmm.
So we build them out of popsicle sticks and straws, and it's really fun because, like, we just started on the big project. It has to spin. The bridge has to span a 50 centimeter gorge. Out of popsicle sticks, and you have to stay on budget. So each popsicle stick costs $1,000.
Whoa.
And the glue.
Do you get to eat the popsicle?
No.
For $1,000, you couldn't give them the popsicle too.
And each glue bottle cost $5,000.
Jeez, so you had to do it like real, and make sure it was going to work. Family members interested in this sort of thing, or is this something that you have caught attention all by yourself?
I just caught attention to it.
Yeah. Aubrey, any family members do this stuff?
No, not really. My dad's in the Coast Guard, and her job is to stay home and watch my little sister.
All right, so we can say it's pretty much all Ms. Bigney's fault.
Pretty much.
You can say that. You can say that to me.
It's Ms. Bigney's fault, but in a good way.
Yeah. That Perfect. Was very nicely put.
Yeah. So what kinds of things did you do to get ready for the talk to the astronaut? You had your question. Did you learn about space or things like that?
I just practiced repeating a question.
You want to make sure you got that right.
But we've been doing a lot of space things, too. We borrowed the moon rocks from NASA, and every class learned about the Apollo missions and the moon rocks. Fifth grade built Estes rockets, and we're going to launch those. We talked about eating in space. We toured the space station by way of video. We did a lot of work with it.
Those things get interesting to you guys?
Mm-hmm. I like the moon rocks.
So you saw a real moon rock?
Mm-hmm. Yes. They got to hold a piece of the moon in their hands.
Did you get to touch them?
No, they're
like a
glass.
Yeah.
I got to touch a moon rock. They have a moon rock, at least they did, at the Smithsonian in Washington. And you wait through a long line of people, and you can... At least you used to be able to. I don't know if they still do that.
They also have one in one of the stained glass windows in the National Cathedral.
Cool. Yeah, moon rocks are cool. So there, I think in space, plenty of opportunity for computing, plenty of opportunity for mechanical type physical engineering. Did you catch a special interest in space, or is this just, this is a cool thing, but I'll stick with what I want to do?
Little half and half.
Okay, so space is kind of interesting. At the end of the contact, when Cliff had everybody gather up and he said, how many people want to be an astronaut? And a few people raised their hand. How many people want to work for NASA? And a lot more people raised their hand. So working for NASA would kind of have something you could do, whether you want to go to space or not. Or do you want to go to space? Either of you?
It scares me.
I like to go, but not
work there. Not tomorrow.
Oh, I'd go tomorrow.
I like to go, but not work there.
Okay.
But we've talked about a lot of different job opportunities with NASA, from the food in space, and remember we saw about the video how the people prepare the food. A lot of the computer engineers, we saw mission control. So there are a lot of jobs with NASA.
There are. Not as many as there used to be, unfortunately. And, you know, hopefully NASA will get back to its glory days. I don't know. You know,
but there's a lot. It's got to get better. It's going to private industry a lot now, too.
Yeah, yeah. So it's not just NASA. It's SpaceX. And you know what SpaceX is? Have you heard of them? Yeah, private company that's sending people, sending mm-hmm. cargo to space right now. And it sounds like you would like to be what they call a space tourist. Buy a ticket, take a ride, go to space, not have to work for it. Just be. So you'll have to be a very rich civil engineer, at least for now.
The richest man in the world is a civil engineer.
Really?
I think he is. I'm not sure.
Cool.
He's from Mexico.
You know who he is?
No, but.
So now we know why Joey wants to be a civil engineer.
Well, no, that's not the reason. I just know like the types of bridges like truss and arch and beam and.
Okay, so that stuff is cool. When you're building your bridge, are you just trying to wing it, or do you do a lot of design?
Design. We have to do design on this one. She gave us like a giant piece of graph paper.
Or it'll fall apart.
Yeah.
And won't make it. I mean, assuming that you have to keep under budget, but your bridge also has to not collapse.
It has to have certain requirements.
Okay, they have to carry some weight, drive some Lego trucks across it or something?
No, we have to, she's like a big block with a chain on it, and there's a hole in the top, but it has to be a small enough hole in the bottom. Well, small enough hole that goes through it, so you can stick the chain through and the block on top so it doesn't collapse, to make just a test.
Okay. Aubrey, what do you do on computers? Facebook?
No, I don't want to, because I know people can post some bad things on there.
Yeah, but what kind of stuff do you like on, I'm just kidding, what kind of stuff do you like on computers?
I just love typing, for one. And I know a lot about it. I know how to get to a lot of things.
On the internet?
Yes.
Okay. But you're careful?
Mm-hmm. Folks. I know what I'm not allowed to look at and what I'm supposed to.
Okay. So as long as your mom's watching, you look at what you're allowed to look at. And as soon as she's not watching, then you go look at what you want to watch.
Yeah. No, Aubrey wouldn't do that, right?
I would not do that.
I'm a troublemaker, as you can tell. So when you guys talked to the astronaut, do you know very much about how you did that?
Amateur radio?
That's the name. Did you learn anything about what this radio thing does for you and how it can work? This is one of those questions where you want to give me a polite answer. And I would like you to give me the most honest answer you can, because, and this is one of those questions that I don't know what the answer is. I didn't ask anybody in advance.
Honestly, not really, but I have a question.
Sure.
Is the AM setting on the radio, does that stand for amateur radio?
It doesn't. It stands for amplitude modulation.
Okay.
and the FM stands for frequency modulation. And we'll do a tutorial here on Ham Radio Now and explain to everyone what that means in a future program, but we won't take time to do that right now. As it turns out, the mode that you were using was FM, but not the FM you can get on your radio dial. We'll go into that in depth at some future point. What I'm curious about is how much you guys learn about ham radio, amateur radio, or whether it's just the telephone operator who made the connection for you. So you learned at least enough to know that that's what it was. Did you look at the radio equipment? Did you look at the dials and knobs and antennas and stuff?
I saw lots of gadgets.
Gadgets.
That's what I saw.
Okay. So you guys walked up to a microphone on a mic stand, not to the radio itself. It was connected to the radio, but it went up and down. So for you, the project was mostly talking to the astronauts.
Yes.
Did you learn about the orbit, the way the space station goes around the Earth?
Yes.
Did you learn about how long you'd be able to talk to him and why?
About 7 to 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I think hours is like 9 minutes and 20 seconds.
Yeah. Why was that? What was it about what the space station is doing that created that limitation?
Because it's the position it is near us. Like, it could, if it was about, like, in, like, Florida, we could talk to it pretty good. But if it was, like, somewhere like Australia, we couldn't talk to it very well.
Why not?
Because we can't get the connection.
Okay. It's do you know why there's no connection when it's on the other side of the world?
It's so far away, I guess. I don't know.
Okay. Well, the answer is, and this will be on the test, so you want to take notes. The Earth is in the way. We can only talk to it when we can see it, not with our eyeballs, but when it is someplace in the sky that the radio signal can get to directly. And the radio signal won't go through the planet. It won't go down. So it has to be overhead, and it's only overhead for about 10 minutes. It's moving pretty quick, what, 17,000 miles per hour or something like that. So that's the deal with talking to the space station through ham radio. The hams that are watching, this program is aimed at hams, and the hams that are watching probably wish that you'd learn more about it, but I'm also thinking you guys probably learned about as much as you could about everything in doing this. Once it was all over with, did it seem to go by in a blur? Did it seem like real fast? I can't hear your heads rattle. You gotta speak.
Yes.
You can tell me about it.
It seemed like it was, like, whatever it was over with, it felt like, just like really short.
Yeah. Now, did it seem worth all the preparation and all that stuff? It was, you know, went by fast, and you spent weeks getting ready. It was weeks?
It was weeks that we got ready. It was months that we spent learning about the space station and learning about space. And we talked a little bit about ham radio, but we do plan to talk to any students interested in ham radio also.
Yeah. I'll talk to you in a minute. This is the kids' time. All right. So before we started rolling the tape, I asked you guys if you could hear what the answer was to your question.
No, it was a little hard to hear mine.
Yeah. It was hard to hear, and you guys were getting shuffled in and out from the microphone pretty quick. So as soon as you finished asking your question, you had to get the heck off and get over in line off the stage. And all that stuff probably meant you could hear the astronaut's voice, but you couldn't hear him exactly what he was saying. Once it was somebody else's question, and you weren't in the spotlight anymore, could you hear the astronaut talking then?
For mine, I just heard, sorry.
You can go.
Okay. For mine, I just heard, like, well, Joey, and then I lost it.
Yep. And that's one of those things that the hams out there that will be watching this and might do this themselves, because these happen all over the country, all over the world, can pay attention to. So your experience is great. I haven't heard very much of that in the past when I've been working on these things. I did hear one student for one of these that I did, when it was all over, their reaction was, that's it? That's all there is? So I don't think they were well prepared. Were you guys prepared to know that how long this thing would last? Sounds like you did. You knew it was going to be 7 to 9 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you were ready. Is there anything about this experience? Well, first of all, did you become rock stars in your family, your friends, around the school?
Oh, yeah. My mom, she posted it on Facebook, and as people came, like, people would come to my house on Fridays, and they would say, oh, hi, Mrs. Rockstar. I saw you on Facebook. How was it? And I'm like, it was pretty good.
Yep.
I liked it.
They put this contact online. Friends and family all gathered around the computers to watch it, either live or on tape delay when they could. So how about you? Did your friends, did they think you were a geek, or did they think you were a star?
Star.
Cool.
My friends wouldn't call me a geek.
They wouldn't call you a geek?
I hope not.
For fear of their lives?
I don't know.
But they wouldn't call you a geek. Are you a girl geek?
I
mean, a girl who likes engineering.
Not.
Yeah. Yeah. You may don't know where you stand on the geek issue, but it's becoming cooler to be a geek. So, Betty's a geek.
I am.
Because if
she's the nicest geek.
If there weren't geeks, there wouldn't be, like, technology and stuff, so.
Well, absolutely.
Yeah. I guess it's a good thing.
Good point, yeah. I don't think it's so much the jocks versus the geeks anymore, but I could be wrong. I'm old. Haven't been in school for a long time. So anything about this experience that you would love to tell the world? It's one of those tough questions that nobody can really answer, but maybe you've got one that you say, I wish everybody would understand, fill in the blank.
That.
Yeah, it's a stumper. Well, it was a cool thing to do. Mm-hmm. You'd do it again. You really wanted to do it. You'd do it again. Mm-hmm. Whether you wanted to go into outer space or not, you'd talk to an astronaut again if you could.
My mom was there. She was so happy. She goes almost in tears.
Wow. That's pretty cool. So what Frank wants to know is, do you guys, this is the question hams ask, and I'm trying to tell you guys not to ask this question. So I'm going to ask the question for you just to make the kids uncomfortable and get the polite response from them. Want to become ham radio operators? Maybe learn a little bit more about it.
Engineer, ham operator, I don't know.
Well, they kind of go together. So we can teach you a little bit more about it if you're interested. We do some cool stuff. So thank you, guys. I am going to excuse you to the other side of the room and bring in the other side of our panel, who is waiting over there in the wings.
You need to...
The fog outside.
No, it's right.
All right, so we have brought Susie and Janice into the conversation. It's just us adults here now. Now we can stop behaving. You guys do public information, and I will get to you in just a minute. But now it's time to talk to the folks that I've been ignoring so studiously as we talk to the kids. Frank, you are president of the Onslow Amateur Radio Club.
Yes.
And it was your group that did the ham radio side of this contact.
Exactly.
Who I am now going to refer to as the telephone operator.
Okay.
The phone company did a lot of work setting up the phone system in our country. Mm-hmm. Not the ham radio system, the telephone system. They did a lot of work. Nobody cares about that. They pick up the phone, they dial. These days they pick up their cell phone and they dial and they talk. And the only time they care about it is when it doesn't work. You were scared to death that this phone call wasn't going to work.
I had... pretty much. I mean, it's you only get one shot at it.
Yeah. There's no brakes on the space station.
No. And if we hadn't have made the contact, we probably would have never had the opportunity to do it again.
Yeah, there have been failures, and there have been second chances, and I'll put some video up of a failure and a second chance following this program. So, Betty, how did this all get started?
Quite a few years ago, when I was teaching in Pennsylvania, I did one of these with the amateur radio group that came to me and asked me if I was interested. And we applied, and we talked to somebody on the space shuttle because they knew I was a spacey person in the school. Yeah. And it worked out great. And when I moved down here, the opportunity for the students... I wanted these students to have that same opportunity. So I applied and didn't
get it. Before, the first time.
And I applied
The hams came to you. So that's how you found out about it. Did you know what ham radio was at that point? As geeky as you were?
Yes.
But you're not a ham.
No, I'm not a ham, but I knew what ham operating was. And the emergency system and through any kind of storms. And so I basically knew what they had done.
Okay. So they came to you and they said, would you like to talk to the space shuttle?
I had to write the application.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Talk to the space shuttle.
Well, I did a lot of spacey things anyway, so that was fine.
So you were... it wasn't a total surprise that this might be able to happen, but had you ever heard of school contacts to the space shuttle with hams?
Yes.
Okay, so because you're a science teacher. That stuff gets circulated.
Well, I applied to be an astronaut, too.
Oh, cool.
So, twice. Didn't make it. One of those losers, but but it was
more of those than there are that make it.
Yeah.
So.
So I wanted that same opportunity for these students down here. So I applied and didn't get it. So the next year I applied again and didn't get it. Third year I applied and got it.
What did you learn about the application process and the not making it?
application process. If you want it bad enough, you keep trying.
Is it is it tough? I mean, there's a lot of things, a lot of hoops to
it
jump
is.
Through.
It was about 7-8 pages long.
Okay. What kind of things do they want to know?
They want to know what contacts you have, what media you have, what you'll be doing with the students, basically what your knowledge is with everything. A lot of questions.
Okay. And do you know why you were turned down the first two times?
No.
It's competition.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't know how NASA and the ARISS program figures things out, but evidently they do.
I think a lot of it is your audience. They want to reach as many students and people as possible.
So what did you change as you went through one to the other to the final successful
one? I think the biggest thing this time was that we were going to have the live feed. And the live feed, I had people that I knew in Pennsylvania and Florida and Ohio that showed that to their students.
Okay.
So we reached a lot more people by way of the live feed.
And that, you think, tipped the balance?
I think so.
Yeah, because your auditorium was stuffed with kids, and that was a couple of hundred. But
it was seen in every school in Onslow County.
Yeah.
And that makes thousands.
Okay. So how did you find a ham?
Well, when I was accepted, I was like, oh, man, am I in trouble now? So I got online, and I looked for Onslow County ham operators and found the Onslow County Club. And Frank's name as president was there, and I thought, oh, he lives in Holly Ridge. That's not too far away. So I got out my phone book, and his phone number was in there. So I called him and tried to explain what it was and what I wanted to do. And there was like this dead silence at the end. And I thought, oh, man, am I in trouble? And then I said, well, are you in? And he said, yeah.
So, slide
and that's
up on
how
your
it started.
Okay. So you got that call.
Mm-hmm.
And then what?
Well, what I did, I had a call meeting with the radio club at our local Golden Corral, and I said, I will explain it to you when you arrive. And the reason I did that is that I wanted to find out who was interested enough and inquisitive enough to find out what it's all about.
So you just told your club, I've got a project.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. If you want to do a project, you didn't say what it was, but right. How special did you hint that it might be?
I said, this is going to be a big, big deal. And
so that scared away 90% of your club.
Yeah, pretty much. But when I got them there and we all sat down and was eating breakfast, that's when I dropped the bomb on them. I said, we have been invited, per se, to make the contact with the International Space Station.
And who else would there be to do it? You were the hams here.
Well, there are other clubs in the area, but not in the county itself.
Yeah.
But
your choice was feather in your cap, black eye. Which do you guys want?
Well, we wanted the feather in the hat.
Yeah, so you did.
I mean, that's the way it was going to go. So, man, when I said it was the International Space Station and I explained to them that it was with Dixon Elementary School and it's with the STEM project, everybody in there raised their hands. We're in. And that's where it started from. So I says, okay, now what do we do? So our mentor, who is Dr. John Clute out of Atlanta, I didn't know him at the time, and I didn't know what direction I was going to have to go to from there. I knew that the guys wanted to do it. So I said, okay, I'll call the ARRL. I said, they got to know the answer. So they put me in charge with, Lord, I can't think of her name now, but Elizabeth somebody. But anyway, she said, well, I know Dr. Clute. He does that. Let me get in touch with him, and I will get back in touch with you. Okay. So she did.
So they're ready to give you some help.
Yeah.
Hold on just a second. Betty, I know you've got to go, right?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to let you go. Is there anything about this whole operation that you think is important for people to know that they might not know now?
I think the most important thing about this operation is that all the people involved, the ham operators, the astronauts, they're touching the future scientists. I know our school is different because of this.
Yeah. I'd like to spend another hour talking to you about just STEM education, because hams, whether we're making future hams or not, understand the value of this. But as briefly as you can tell me, how are you keeping STEM going? Because out there in the world, it is not valuable. Not, it is valuable to the world, but it is not valued by the world.
Because they don't understand what STEM is. My students, we've done the science, we did the scientific method, we're doing the engineering design process now, where they're actually designing and building things, like designing rockets, designing bridges.
The popsicle stick bridge.
And I have students...
You know they weren't going to let them eat the popsicles, they just build the bridge.
I have students right now, I wrote a grant with the Civil Air Patrol, who is very interested in STEM, and they gave us 10 robot arm kits. And I have fifth grade students that are actually going to build the robot arms. So they'll be building and designing their own.
Okay, so you're big, big time into this. Have you thought much at this point now about adding ham radio to STEM classes?
Oh, we've already talked about it. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. So you were aware of ham radio, but it had not naturally occurred to you to do that. But
well,
now you've got this
probably
connection.
Not occurred to me to do that, because up until 2 years ago, I was in a regular classroom. And then when they moved me to my current job, they called it just science. And I teach science to every child in the entire building, all 900-some. But now this year, they changed it to STEM. So when it was science, I had to go by the national standards. And now that it's STEM, I have a little more leeway to put things into the program that will fit into it. And I think ham radio will fit into the science, technology, okay. engineering, and mathematics.
No ham radio in the national standards. No ham radio in the national standards. I'm not pointing at you guys. I'm pointing to that camera behind you. I'll have to think about that. Well, Betty, congratulations on the contact and the success. And I wish we could go on for another couple of hours, but you got ice cream to get.
You
have a celebration.
I do.
Is it an ARISS celebration, or are you celebrating something else?
No, it's... Because
that's over with. That's a couple weeks ago.
The week after ARISS, we had our Science Olympiad competition, and I coached a first, second grade team, and they did fantastic. They took second place, and they also took the Spirit Award. So we were just having a little celebration today.
And now they get ice cream.
Now they get
no
ice cream.
No popsicles, but they get
they
the ice
cream. They got snacks every time they came.
All right. We will let you go.
Okay. Thank
and
you.
And I'll move you guys one notch over. So back to Frank. Mm-hmm. Your group was enthusiastic.
Yes.
It was very. Excited.
Yes.
Why the heck? How many people knew about what this program was all about?
Not too many. Our radio club is relatively a young club. I've been club president here for about 6-7 years now. And we had about, I think we had 26 members in the club then, and we've grown to 63.
How did you do that?
That's a good question. I try to keep things active, you know, to let the people in the club do things and learn things. I have hands-on classes, dipole antenna building.
So you were attracting the hams in the area? Were you making new hams, making bacon?
Yes, new hams. We have a pretty good VE program here. We do ours. A ham or a prospective ham wants to call our VE coordinator. Then he sets it up. It doesn't have to be on a specified time. Anytime he wants to take a test, and then we get together.
To make it easy.
Yeah.
Teach classes?
Yes, sometimes. Not all the time. When one of our members, Jerry Jones, he teaches it if he's not teaching any classes at the college in Jacksonville. He's pretty good at it. He's been doing it quite a while, so he can handle the class, you know, pretty good. But, you know, it's the the fact of the matter is there was a lot of the hams in our club that really didn't know how to do it. And I was kind of vague on it myself because it's been 30 years since I've worked a satellite.
So you'd never been involved in a space shuttle or space station contact. You had worked satellites a little bit.
Oh, yes.
Back in the day.
Back in the day, yeah. But Dr. John Clute, as I said earlier, he was extremely helpful. His knowledge that he gave to us, was incredible. And any amateur radio club that gets involved in doing an ARISS contact, I would strongly suggest to make sure you get a mentor. Don't try to do it on your own because it won't work.
Yeah. You do this through the league. The league is the ham radio point of contact for ARISS.
Well, you know, and it...
And they hooked you up.
Yeah. And, of course, when Bill Moraine, our section manager, or assistant section manager now, he helped me and put out some feelers because we were trying to find the right equipment to do it with. Well, the radios was no problem and the coax, but finding the right antenna was a big deal. And see, around in this area, we're so close to the ocean that we're very hurricane prone. And you're not going to find that kind of equipment around here. It's relatively expensive, so nobody's going to invest that kind of money to have it, torn up in a hurricane. So.
Give me the quick list of what hardware you needed to have.
The main radio station, the primary station, it was a 12-element circularly polarized Yagi antenna, and it was attached to a azimuth elevation rotator system that was computer controlled.
Standard satellite stuff.
Yes, standard satellite.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it will start over here on this horizon and track to over there based on a pre-programmed trajectory.
Depending, which you'll probably get into this later, as to what happened.
Yeah,
there for a few
I'll
seconds,
ask you about that.
But that was something we really didn't know was going to happen, but after it did, I figured out why it did.
Okay, so you got to the bottom of it. What we're talking about is halfway through the contact, and you've heard the contact, and the signal got noisy in the middle. It's because the rotor program decided to swing the antenna around 360 degrees?
Well, it did because when you came out of the park position and you told the software to start tracking the ISS, well, it came around one direction till it got it. Well, as it was moving on across the horizon, well, it's not going to go continuously in that same direction. It's going to stop.
Can't go round and round and round, right. Or it would wrap the coax up around the...
So it stopped, and when it did, it says, I got to get around the other way. So that's when it turned, and naturally we lost it for a few seconds until it came back around to where it, where we lost it.
Were you looking for the defibrillators for your heart at that point?
No. After one of the members that told me, said that thing went crazy. It was doing fine, and all of a sudden it started turning the other way. And when I looked up at it, I said, I know why it's doing it. I said it stopped. It couldn't go any farther, so it had to come back around to get back to the coordinates up where the space station was at. That and the audio, those are two main things that the clubs have got to understand, that in the beginning, the room was empty when we were setting up and testing audio. And then when it came around to the contact time, the gym was full. Well, there goes your acoustics.
Yeah.
So you got to crank the audio up.
Yep. So that was the audience, the big, huge audience,
yes.
was a variable that you had not been able to take into account because it was never there before.
No, it wasn't.
And you'd think of the audience. What difference is that going to make?
And two, the way that the PA system was situated in the gym, the speakers were facing all the way to the back of the gym from the stage.
To the audience.
Because
you want to play all this stuff to them.
Okay. When the kids were up there asking their question, they were actually behind the speaker.
Yeah.
So it was almost impossible for them to hear what the astronaut was saying. But once they got through and they came around and sat down in front, they could hear the answers to the other questions then.
Yeah. So those are the two big lessons learned?
Yes.
Exactly. How would you deal with the rotator thing? What would you do differently in advance? Had someone said, watch out, it could go the wrong way?
No, I don't think there's anything that can be done about it, because you have to set up and point the Yagi at true north to begin with, because that has to be in relation to the software itself. Now, I mean, the software doesn't know what north is, but you're telling it where north is at to begin with.
I guess I would think that the program would be smart enough to know where it's got to go from beginning to end and point itself at the beginning so it can make the full sweep. But this, I don't know the satellite stuff. Satellite guys will know that.
It works off of the Kepler's. You have to download that, which we did that Sunday evening or Monday evening before the contact, Sunday evening. That, the Kepler's, is the exact coordinates of where the space station is going to travel from one horizon to the other.
Again, standard satellite stuff.
Yes.
You remember that from the old days.
Well, the thing is, you're looking at your degrees from the horizon to where the antenna is going to have to track it from. And that information is in the software, and it talks to the controller for the rotator system itself. And if you don't have those updated, you could be off, which don't take much considering the fact that that thing is 300 miles from you, traveling at 17,000 miles an hour.
Yeah.
You can be off just a little bit and you'll never hear it. But another one of the most critical thing I can come up with, and I probably aggravated enough of the guys that were involved in this thing that they probably would never speak to me, but you've got to
But now
practice.
You're the ham radio rock star, so they have
well,
to.
Well, the coordinator. I'm not going to put myself on a pedestal because I'm just with the rest of the
lot of hams put in a lot of work.
Yeah. But you have got to practice and practice and practice and practice. Even the guys that were not even going to be the main operator or the secondary operator, they were sitting at their house, which we could work the space station on packet. And, I mean, I had the frequencies, but I couldn't give them out. But
yeah, we know the downlink is 145.8.
Eight, yeah. But anyway, they would be at home at nights, and they would pull up and see when the space station was going to be coming over our area, and they would actually try to work it, you know, on their home antennas, which you can do that. But your percentage of getting a good rock solid 10-minute contact out of it is going to be slim to none. I mean, you've got to have the right stuff to do it.
Yeah. So the circularly polarized antenna.
Yes.
On the as L rotor, all that stuff is important for getting the best possible chance.
If you're
going
to work satellites, yes, you've got to have that.
Yep. So you did a lot of practice. Anything specific come to mind about how you did the practice? Did you try to duplicate every parameter?
Yes. What we did, we actually had, the word I used was a full dress rehearsal. We had five of those.
Five?
Yes. And two of them, or three of them, were here at the school. What we did, I wanted to get the kids in the first time, and we set up just exactly like we were going to make a contact with the space station. And one of our members, David Wager, he was our astronaut, and he went down the road about 4 or 5 miles, and we actually had the kids to come up and speak in the microphone just like it was on the day of the contact. But we used our local ham repeater to be the uplink and downlink.
Mm-hmm.
And David was the astronaut, so when the kids asked the question, then he would come back with the answer. our main target there was to make sure that the kids didn't have mic fright, how clear their voice was going to be, how loud it was. And of course, Betty, she told them, you know, you got to have your big boy and girl voices.
Your outside voice.
You got to do that. So, I mean, they took to it just like duck to water. And then after we did that, we did another dress rehearsal here. We did one at my house. And the main objective is to get the guys used to setting up. The first time we came up here to set up, which John was with us because it is his equipment, and he had a super nice setup. It was on a trailer. It's his portable setup. And that's what he uses at field day. And he said, well, where I live is in a restricted area, and I can't use this equipment, but I can hook it to my truck and go off out in the woods somewhere and set up, or out in the field somewhere and set up. Yeah. And
now, he done this for ARISS contacts before?
Oh, yes.
Okay, so.
And he is a member of AMSAT also.
He knew what he was doing.
Oh, yes. Definitely knew what he was doing. But
did he give you guys room to do your own figuring things out, or did he just that say, I'm taking over, you're doing it my way?
No, actually, he and I let the guys, I didn't say you and you are going to learn how to set this up. I said, I need four guys to come over here and work with John to learn how to set this stuff up. I didn't point to any fingers to who, I let them decide. And the reason you want to do that is that, yeah, four people is a bit much on setting up. But the thing is, on the day of the contact, you might have one or two of them that's had an emergency and can't even be there.
Yep. So you need to back up and back up to the backup.
Yeah. I mean, the clubs that are going to do this, you think you're going to have everything figured out, and we did. I mean, we thought we had it all right, and then the antenna.
Yep. You had backup equipment, too.
Yes, we had a Workman 2-meter 440 vertical. Now, both of the antennas, the vertical and the Yagi, we did have amplifiers on them. You want to set your amplifiers up as close to the antenna as you can so it compensates for the loss in the coax, because you got to get a minimum of 100 watts out.
Yeah, you're about 100 feet or so from where the station was, where the antennas ended up.
We were 185 feet.
Didn't seem that far. It was outside the auditorium and then across.
Yeah, across the
Yeah, across the street, mm-hmm. across the driveway.
Yeah.
And that adds up fast.
It does. It adds up super fast. Now, the main station that we had, we were using Heliax. And actually, it was supposed to go up to our repeater site, but we found out it wasn't our coax, thank goodness, but we'd already bought it. Well, that was 260 feet. Well, yeah, we didn't need but 185, but I'm not going to cut the coax. You know, we might have to have it sometime.
Yeah, but the loss through Heliax is not so bad. So.
Yeah, I mean, it was flat.
You were better off with 250 feet of Heliax than 180 feet of
RG8.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The next best solution we had was on the backup station, which was the dual band vertical. And we were using RG-213 military grade,
okay.
Which was, that's not too bad. You had a little bit more loss in it, but not like it would have been RG-8. So good coax, good antenna system, practice.
So I am guessing that you never went through a full antenna swing part of your practice, or this problem would have shown its ugly head?
Well, no, because we were actually, you know, doing it on packet. Our times that we're actually doing our dress rehearsals, it sounds odd, but we never could get a decent pass of the space station.
Yeah.
I mean, it was slim to none. Well, you got to have it coming so close to you in order for the antenna to pick it up.
Yeah. So, do you know what the elevation of the shuttle was at Apogee?
When the day of the contact?
Yeah.
41 degrees.
So that's not ideal.
No.
That's...
No. What we wanted was Thursday, which we had an 83 degree angle then. That's what we were shooting for. That would have been fantastic. But NASA, they have their ways of, and you have to take into consideration the problems that they had had the week before.
You know, what happened?
Well, SpaceX, they had...
The difficulties with getting their supply truck up and down.
Right. And then the computer going down on the space station itself. So that threw everything behind. So NASA comes up and says, well, we got to get you on Monday.
Yeah.
Because we finally got our supplies there, which was a couple of weeks late.
You didn't even know if you're going to be able to do this until fairly last minute.
Let's see. We got it on Good Friday.
And the contact was the next Monday.
Yes, and the contact was the following Monday.
Yeah.
Onslow County schools were closed that week. And she can fill you in more about what that went on. I did get in touch with Betty, and she was just about in Ohio. And I said, Betty, I said, I got a date. She says, when is it? I said, you might ought to turn around and come back. I said, it's going to be Monday. She says, oh, Lord.
Now, was the school back open on Monday?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's why all the students were available.
Well, some schools, Onslow County's closed that week, and then there are some schools that are closed the next week.
Yeah, that's the Easter break.
Well, we were only there that Monday because it was a makeup day, snow day.
Right.
Because the kids were supposed to be on.
Right. But, you know, as far as doing this, it was a good shot in the arm for our radio club. It put us on the big map, and it was a good shot in the arm for the school systems, put them on the map. And it was an excellent shot for the county itself.
All right.
History was made. I mean, it probably not, well, I'm not going to say this, but I'm going to say it. It probably won't happen in Onslow County again.
Well, you never know.
You never know.
But it could. But
there's a whole lot of counties in the United States.
Yeah, there's a lot of competition for doing
this. Yes, it is.
I got one technical question, and then I want to go on to that put you on the map stuff, which is going to bring in our public information people. The technical question is, as that signal is disappearing, did you guys think about going to your backup, the backup antenna, the backup radio?
I was getting ready to do that, but after I saw what it was, I said, nope, I'm going to give it a few seconds because I know it will come back.
Okay. So you got a good idea of what's happening.
Once he told me what it had done, I said, it's going to come back. I said, it's going to track right back around to the other because we had too good of a signal to begin with.
Yep. You had guys out at your trailer looking at the antennas.
Yes.
And guys inside the auditorium running the radio. So you able to talk to each other? Did you work out an intercom?
We didn't have to. Our club has got a 440 simplex frequency that we use.
So that's what you were doing to talk?
Yes.
440 simplex.
I didn't want to do anything on the 2-meter end of it because I didn't want interference to get over into the conversation or coming in on it.
Yeah, so UHF was smart.
Yeah. Then that's another thing clubs need to take into consideration. You always want to have good, clean, clear contact on a frequency that is far away from the one you're going to be working the space station on.
Yeah, yeah.
We were told, as a rule, clubs normally get a year to a year and a half to prepare for this. And I had gotten an email, and it stated that if we hadn't had our equipment by now, our chances of making a contact were slim to none. Well, they had a year to a year and a half to do it. We only had 90 days.
It was hurry up all the way around.
Yes, it was. And we pulled it off. And my hats is off to the county school systems for their help. They did great for us getting their publicity, the TV stations and all, and you guys, which I think Bill was helping y'all to get in. But it was awesome.
All right. You know. So I want to go to this putting them on the map. And we need to change tapes, and I think we'll stop this program at this point and do a follow-up program. I mean, be right there on the internet for you to watch as soon as you click the button. So we'll stop this one for right now, and we'll be right back with putting this ham radio activity, ARISS, in Onslow County, North Carolina, on the map We'll be right back. Over and out.